بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. One of the ways to understand certain concepts in Quran, or sometimes the vocabulary of Quran, because Quran really brought a new vocabulary in order like to stimulate a new ideas. And the people who basically read it and want to understand it and to be guided by its really light. And one of the concepts that you all are aware of is really the concept of huda, guidance, and which is basically compatible with the name or the title of the surah, An-Noor. Okay, so as we said, Noor becomes the metaphor for guidance. To understand further a concept like Al-Huda, you can also look at its opposite. So you have a deeper understanding, okay? And Quran really tells us about that. For example, in the case of the people of Thamud, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَأَمَّا ثَمُودُ فَهَدَيْنَاهُمْ. For the people of Thamud, we guided them. فَاسْتَحَبُّ الْعَمَى عَلَى الْهُدَى. They preferred blindness over guidance. It's very compatible. Take the light, even if you are not blind, you will be behaving like a blind person, not able really to navigate. You see the idea of ama, blindness, is really the opposite of guidance. Okay, so I would say this is a way to understand further, okay, the vocabulary of Quran, because it's not just a word, but it's a concept that that word really connotes, okay, or tries really like to express, okay, and so we have seen last time the different manifestations in the universe, okay, and I want you to see the human being as the echo of this long journey that this universe has taken until the human being basically was created and appeared really on this earth. Okay, so you can see in yourself and in the universe around you this very long journey, millions of years. Now we understand it better. Okay, when the universe was created and all the changes, the metamorphosis, the evolution that took place over millions of years until we came as the highest manifestation of life. And that journey of the universe continues from this life towards a bigger life. And the same thing, the human being has also a journey. And we are accompanying the universe in that journey. And as we are really moving in that journey, we want to be in harmony with that universe. We saw it last time. The universe and its elements and phenomena, they are making tasbih. They are praying. And the same way you feel when you pray, when you say, Subhanallah, you are not a stranger in this existence. You are not alone. Okay? And as you move in this life, in this journey, you need also guidance. If you want to do anything, you take any action in this existence, it cannot be incompatible with the universe. I want to build a bridge. If I make miscalculations, that bridge will not work. And the first one to fall on is me. Is that right? I'll be the first to try it and it will collapse under me. What do we say? Why that bridge did not work? Because it is not compatible with the universe. The universe did not endorse it. The universe did not approve it. I have a medicine that it is causing people to die or have severe side effects, and immediately it is withdrawn from the market. Why? Again, yes, we say because of these, but in fact, if you go deeper at the conceptual level, at the intellectual level, you are saying, in other words, that this medicine is not compatible with the universe. Yeah, very important. I mean, I'm saying these things over and over again because we want to send that message to our kids, to our students. When they are doing an experiment in the biology lab or chemistry lab or physics lab, okay, we want them to understand that we have a reference that it's telling us if we are doing the right thing or not. If it is not right, it means that the universe did not approve it. They are not carrying with them Quran or Injil or Torah to tell them if they are doing the right thing. No, these will have a different role. But for the action to work or not work, to happen or does not happen, you need a reference for it. And again, you see how much we are bombarded. And I don't really have probably a better word, but really we are bombarded all the time. Every time we read Quran, you see how many times the universe is brought to the discussion. And you will wonder why, okay, in a surah that is talking about social norms and social values and social practices and is bringing the universe into the mix. So the more we are bombarded, okay, to realize how important is the universe in being a reference for our actions. You cannot go against it. Have you seen a scientist saying that I am right and the universe is wrong? My data did not really lead me to the right results, and they say no, my data is right, and or my inferences are right, and the data does not support the what is data? What does it mean, data? It means that the universe evidence. What do we mean by evidence based? I need compatible with the universe as a reference. And that's very important. For the last 500 years, everything you have seen in terms of this rapid development, because human beings realized how important to make the universe their reference. Not anymore thinking about things in a closed room. Go out, verify what you have, what conclusions your mind, your reasoning has reached, see if you can verify it by outside, by the universe.
Are you saying that they realize that they cannot work against the universe?
Against, you cannot.
You have to work like, for example, gravity, mm-hmm. you cannot negate the gravity, you have to use that for
exactly.
your body, things like
you
that.
Don't go against it,
right.
but you under, the more you understand, you liberate yourself from it. You are not going against it. And if human beings succumb to the idea of gravity in this fashion, we would not have been able to fly. But the more you understand it, the more you are able to liberate yourself from it. Yes, I would say Einstein is the best person who understood Newton. Otherwise, he would not be able like to transcend him, not to crush him. Please, not to crush the previous paradigm, but to bring it to the higher level of understanding. And what Einstein would bring will all makes still Newton's physics applicable within the new paradigm, but not limited to it. Yes?
I have an example of that, what you're saying. Mm-hmm. My frame of reference as a nurse, when Florence Nightingale went to Crimea, mm-hmm. they didn't have a germ theory yet.
Mm-hmm.
She believed in good and evil. Good was clean and sunlight. Bad was dirty and filthy. And all the soldiers that were dying, first thing she did was came in and opened the window and put fresh air and washed things and cleaned things. And people got better.
Mm-hmm.
But from her frame of reference, she was bringing godliness and goodliness and cleanliness. And that's right after that is when they understood the germ theory because of the invention of the microscope. And then they could take it one step further to see the reason why.
Yes, exactly.
Which she didn't yet understand. And when she first heard that, she said, there's no way there's little monsters.
Yes, 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 very good.
That was the next level.
Oh, no question about it. Take it further. Take it further. A surgeon is sitting beside you. Okay, now we take it for granted, like we have to wash our hands. I mean, thoroughly before we go to the operating room. But see how many people died before we realized that that was really a shift in the paradigm. You see, now we take it for granted because we are practicing it, we forget about it. But see it in that at that time, how it liberated us from a previous paradigm. And see how it become more compatible with our understanding of the universe. What does it really mean to understand microorganisms? They are part of the universe. I cannot deny them. But before I knew about them, I am blind. Okay? The previous paradigm was working to a certain extent. Okay? But the more you free yourself from the existing, what you have so far reached, you will be able to move to the next level. But you cannot deny the universe as the larger laboratory to verify. You want the endorsement of the universe. You see, that's, and this is why we need to bring that, okay, when every time I see the universe being brought to the discussion, it's really like to remember, for my actions, I need the universe. But the universe cannot give me direction.
Can you give an example of a social practice, a social norm that is maybe...
Yeah. I mean, exactly.
I know you talked about the
yes.
science, but I'm
yes,
talking
yes.
about the social.
This is where we need the universe cannot contribute to your social norms. Okay, I can build a building, and it is sound. It's not falling. Okay, because the universe, okay, is endorsed it. Okay, you followed the right calculations, the right laws, and everything. And the building, but how are you going to use that building? Okay, you can make out of it a church, and it is going in the right direction. Make it like a casino for Gambling. It is this, the universe doesn't tell you what you are going to do. The universe does not give you direction. It tells you about the action itself. But the direction of the action is completely different thing. This is the basic idea that we need to understand. Let me just elaborate on this, because this is where, okay, we are not, and sometimes the confusion arises. Every action has a direction. If you like, action plus direction is a deed, if you like. Some people like to do it this way. But I will not make it more complicated. But every action you take in this life, it needs a direction. The universe tells you about the action only. I can have a knife and to cut. I can cut an apple, but God forbid I can cut. You use a knife in your surgery, but for a good direction. Imagine somebody looking from outside, cutting the leg of somebody with gangrene, without understanding, oh my God, this is a bad thing. But when they understand why you are doing it, the direction of your action, they say, sorry, I understand what you are really doing. But the action itself, okay, it's the same. It is really the same. But the direction is different. The universe does not help you with the direction. In other words, have you seen someone drowning, asking the sea or the ocean to save them? Have you seen some? I mean, people start praying. But I have not heard about somebody praying to the ocean. So in other words, the universe is a reference for our actions. But I need a different reference to help me with the social norms, with the values, how to direct my action. Make sense?
And that's where the Quran is.
Here the revelation comes. The same way we saw the human being evolving in his journey, the way we saw the human being coming to this existence, echoing that long journey of changes, metamorphosis, evolution, okay? The same thing happened with the revelation. The revelation was not static also, but it moved over thousands of years, accompanying the human being, guiding the human being in the area of direction, guidance. It was the light all the time. Look how Quran describes at-Tawrah, فيها هدى ونور. Guidance and light. Guidance and light. See how Quran describes the gospel, Injil, فيه هدى ونور. Never Quran says that Taurat and Injil are really like have been changed or something. Never. Quran is saying they have been changed from their location. This is for that time. You are trying to apply it in a completely different time. If you see it as a project, you see the changes that happened through time until we have the perfection of that revelation. And with now the changes have to happen within. It took millions of years until the universe really reached its perfection. Quran refers to it fi sittati ayyam. Six intervals, if you like. Not the day that you and me know it today. I mean, we define it today. But it's like an era. Now I can refer to it all the time for my actions. But when it comes to the direction of my action, I need revelation. And now I have the revelation in its perfect and completed form, without denying the one behind it, before it. But you confirm it and take it to the next level. مُصَدِّقًا لِمَا بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ مِنَ الْكِتَابِ وَمُهَيْمِنًا عَلَيْهِ. Confirming what came before it and taking it to an overarching horizon. Very important, my dear brothers and sisters. It is fundamental, I would say. You will not find this in any book, I can assure you. And this is not from me. I mean, it was the result of a lot of conversations and readings to come up with this type of synthesis. I am honest with you, okay? But this is a very fundamental, I mean, you got it? Okay? I mean, and now when you work, you move with a vision, with light. You know what is the role of the revelation and what is the role of the universe. They are not against each other, but each one has its own role. One for the action and one for the direction. Yes?
So that's a very good point about, you know, how following the rules of the universe, mm-hmm. like in mechanical or the regular rules that we know about, you know, building and so on. Now, the guidance part is kind of different because, you know, I'm using this verse that talks about فَكَأَيْنْ قَرَتْنْ أَهْلَكْنَاهَا وَهِيَ ظَالِمَةً فَهِيَ خَوَيْتْمَ عَلَى الْرَشَاءُ وَإِلْمَنْ طَلَتْنْ وَقَصْرُ الْمُشْرَةِ. So here you have, materially have used the methods to build a palace, mm-hmm. to have a well.
Mm-hmm.
However, it looks like the fact to him that enters, so it's not enough that you have been following the specific rules of building.
Mm-hmm.
So, for example, if we follow the rules of maintaining a building, mm-hmm. that doesn't continue to keep it,
mm-hmm.
according to this, but that is an entry of another factor that is not, as you call it, the rules of the universe. So the rules of the universe mechanically can build the building, but you cannot maintain it without that factor from outside.
The direction. Let us take that very example. Okay, who uses? How many people use the well? The majority. The well for water, for the life of any community. Quran is saying that the well is not working. But how many people use the palace? Very few people. This is the one that is very well built. You see the discrepancy, the imbalance in the society? That's what will destroy. This Quran is saying this discrepancy, this disparity is responsible for the destruction. Disparity is direction. Now we know how to treat, not let us say breast cancer, but you agree with me that there is a lot of disparity even in applying the treatment of breast cancer across racial and socioeconomic groups. Make sense? Hepatitis C treatment is available. Very expensive. Okay? But I can tell you there is a lot of disparity. Does the poor really get that type of treatment? I'm not only talking about the United States, all over the world. So in terms of finding the drug, we followed the reference, which is the universe, and we have done very good job, and I am not underestimating that. Don't misunderstand me. This is very important, and this is why Quran is bombarding us You need to follow the universe as reference for your action. Okay? But the direction, who will tell you about balance? Who will tell you about justice? The universe? The universe doesn't talk about about justice. So you need another reference to provide us with the. If it is left for the human being, the human mind, you see what will happen, what type of direction they will take us. But believe me, every time, forget about the religious background. Every time, people will arise against something wrong. What will be the driving force? A high value. Could be dignity. Could be freedom. Justice or injustice versus injustice. Equality of between genders. Equality between races. Acceptance of different cultures. The school where my kids went in my town, they pride themselves that they have 62 languages being spoken by their children, by their students. They pride themselves. You feel happy and you want to support that direction. That this value of what Quran calls ta'aruf. Instead of taking this difference in the language as a reason to divide among people, you are saying, no, we are happy that we are all together learning from each other, about each other, and learning together. From where you can get that? The universe does not tell you. So really the example that you gave is very beautiful, but it needs a little bit of analysis, okay, in terms of what was really behind the destruction. Quran is bringing you the disparity. Only the few are really benefiting from what this universe provides you. The universe is very generous. If you follow the rules, the universe will give you. And Quran make it very clear, equal opportunity. كُلَّا نُمِدُّ هَؤُلَاءِ وَهَؤُلَاءِ مَنْ عَطَاءِ رَبِّكَ. Doesn't matter. هؤلاء and هؤلاء could be believers, non-believers, this culture, that culture, this language, that. Quran covered all. Quran, the universe is not going to ask you, where are you from? The universe will ask you, follow the rules. If you follow the rules, I will respond to you. And I will give you back. If you don't blame me, blame yourself. Revisit your hypothesis. Revisit the data. Your approach is wrong. سواء, this is what really equal opportunity. سواء للسائلين. سواء is equal. للسائلين, those who are asking. If you ask the universe, and you work on your, and you refine your question, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, the universe is under direct order. Executive order, if you like, to respond to you as long as you ask the right question. If you ask the wrong question, it is your problem, not the problem of the universe. But what are you going to do with the products? With what the universe provides you, it needs a different reference. You need the revelation. Why the revelation? Because it is independent of us as a human beings. Because we are not like the universe or like the angels. We have one direction. We have our own desires, our own interests, and you will see it. Believe me, you will see it today. You need something independent. And the revelation has that characteristic. Now, is there a possibility for the revelation to be abused and like to be like used like in the wrong direction? Yes. It is possible. And Quran does not deny that. And this is why the rest of the people have to be very vigilant. I can take the, instead of using the religion to be a source of light, I can lean of it, on it, okay, to further my own interests. God forbid. You remember in the past we said it's like you see, you saw this stature of the drunken like leaning on the pole on the light of the light street light. Why he is leaning? Why he is like doing this like, to support himself? So he is asking the pole to support him, not to be guided by the light. It's very interesting. Like, I mean, a metaphor, okay? So instead of using the light of the street light to be guided, he is using it to lean on it. The same thing religion can happen, what can happen to religion. We can lean on it for our own interest instead of being enlightened by its light. So the role of revelation is guidance. The role of revelation to be light, and hence the name of the surah, light, An-Noor. So the same way Quran is talking about the universe, immediately will say, لَقَدْ أَنزَلْنَا آيَاتٍ مُبَيِّنَاتٍ وَاللَّهُ يَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ إِلَى صِرَاطٍ مُسْتَقِيمٍ. We are all pursuing the straight path. But the universe cannot give me that guidance. I need another source. Ayat, anzalna, ayatin mubayyinat. We need another type of sign in the form of revelation. But the beauty that Quran will help, will tell you that we'll call both of them ayat. What you see in the universe is described as ayat, and the building blocks of Quran is are called ayat. Have you seen someone hugging a sign on the highway? This is not your interest, not the sign itself, where it is leading you. You see? So the universe, the ayat in the universe will help me how to act. But the ayat of the revelation will help me to know the direction of my action. Make sense? Okay. Take the example that Quran brings before us about slaughtering an animal. Slaughtering an animal, it's the same. However you say Bismillah or you don't say Bismillah, as an action, it's the same. But one you can eat, and you can, another one you cannot eat. What is the difference? The direction that you are giving to your action. Simple example. Is that right? Do you eat from an animal that was slaughtered to an idol, for example? You don't. We become very sensitive to that. Culturally, I mean, socially, in every way. But we don't understand it. Why? You see what I mean? Why I don't eat from that slaughter? Although it is slaughtered the same way. But one was given the direction in the name of Allah, and another one in the name of something else. That's the beauty. This is why I'm saying we need to bring it to the deeper level. Because then it becomes a way to understand other things in life. It becomes my vision. Or part of my vision. So next time your kid comes to you and asks you about something in physics or tells you about an experiment, allude, direct them to in that direction. Tell them how important is the universe as reference to tell you if you are doing the right thing or not. But does not tell you in what direction you go. You need another reference.
In other words, universe is like in a sense lab.
Bigger lab, the biggest lab, yes.
You the result. Mm-hmm. What direction you gave, what action you took is wrong or right. That's all it does.
In terms of the action itself.
Exactly.
The execution of the action itself.
Right.
But doesn't tell you in what direction you are taking that action.
Right. But it is honest.
Honest, very honest.
Right,
very honest. Not only honest, but Quran is saying that this universe is again under direct order to respond to you. Regardless who you are. Regardless. Doesn't ask you. You don't show them your ID. You see what I mean to the universe? No. سَوَاءً لِلسَّائِلِينَ I have not seen anything more equal than that. سَوَاءً لِلسَّائِلِينَ Whoever asks, the universe is ready to respond to you, provided that you ask the right question. If the question itself is wrong, go and refine it. Question, I mean like hypothesis. Your hypothesis. Go and change it. Or your hypothesis is wrong. Sometimes you have to do it to prove that this, it may look right on paper. It looks very logical on paper. But when you collect the data, you find that this is not really true. So nobody will say, no, my hypothesis is right, but you have, and the universe is wrong. Never happened. Again, I am dwelling on this because it is really, really fundamental. And now you can see the other side, the side of the direction. Read with me. وَيَقُولُونَ آمَنَّا بِاللَّهِ وَبِالرَّسُولِ وَأَطَعْنَا They say, we believe in Allah and in His Prophet, and in the Prophet. وَأَطَعْنَا And we are obeying. Again, here, Allah wa Rasul, same axis. They are not against each other. Don't separate. Don't separate, don't divide. But we distinguish between Allah and the Prophet. But they have this, they follow the same scheme, the same plan. Okay? ثُمَّ يَتَوَلَّى فَرِيقٌ مِّنْهُمْ مِّنْ بَعْدِ ذَلِكَ After they declare that they believe and they are really obeying what is coming from Allah and His Prophet, they turn away. Some of them. وَمَا This is the point. وَمَا أُولَٰئِكَ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ They are not believers. Yes, they can say it all day. So iman, belief, is not a lip service. You remember what we said about al-mu'mineen as a class in the society? Not a socioeconomic class, but based on values. A class that is very adherent to the high values. And we said they are really the ones who provide the counter argument of those who were trying to disrupt the fabric of the society. those who were trying to spread fahisha. Al-mu'minun were the ones who are supposed to spread light. مَثَلُ نُورِهِ. You remember? Allahu نُورُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. So, can you imagine? You come to a lighted room, okay? And so, can you go to a lighted room and there is no source of light? There is no way. You don't accept it. So Allah is saying, I am the source of the light of the heaven and earth, but I want the believers to reflect that light. مثل نوره, the example of his light in the heart of the believer. So there are people who were spreading the rumors, spreading al-fahisha, spreading all these reprehensible social practices, because we are trying to see these verses in the light, in view of the surah as one unit. So you need the believers who basically are guided by the light of the reference, of direction, the revelation, okay? And become the source for that light to not only to other human beings, but to everything in heavens and earth. You see where the human being is a place. It's not only the status that the human being is given, but at the same time the duty, the responsibility. Can we elevate ourselves to that level? Can we create an environment for our kids and students to elevate themselves to that level, to become the light, to reflect that light all over around them? So Quran is saying these people, so we have another attribute of the believers. You remember قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ, and you will see it. These are the reasons why the believers will succeed. Not because they call themselves مُؤْمِنُونَ, but because of their attributes, what they are doing, because of their actions and the direction that is given to their actions. And one, the surah is adding another attribute, that also the believers are the one who will take that light and spread it. They take it as a source of guidance, not like that group who may be hypocrites, munafiqun. Later on, Quran will say, "Fi qulubihim maradun." Their faith is shaky. They have a disease in their hearts. They are not cured yet. وَإِذَا دُعُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ لِيَحْكُمَ بَيْنَهُمْ إِذَا فَرِيقٌ مِنْهُمْ مُعْرِضُونَ. If they are called, if they are asked or requested to come to Allah and His Prophet to judge in any matter, they don't accept it. Why they don't accept it? Because it is against their own interest. If it is compatible with their interest, they became the best believers. And وَإِذَا فَرِيقٌ وَإِنْ يَكُنْ لَهُمُ الْحَقِّ يَأْتُوا إِلَيْهِ مُذْعِنِينَ. If the truth is on their side, compatible with their own interest, they will come to it in complete obedience. While you see the Quran present high values in a different way. You can call yourself, you can belong to any group you want. This is your right to add any identity you want. But Quran is saying, don't put any of these identities, being race, language, religion, even religion, socioeconomic status, any of these parameters, you can use them as much as you want. And you can use them to identify yourself through them as much as you want. This is your freedom. But Quran is saying that I have only one request. Don't put any of these parameters above high values. Take the value of justice. Okay? What does Quran say about it? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, asking us to be just in our judgments, even if it is against ourselves. وَلَوْ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِكُمْ أَوْ الْوَالِدَيْنِ أَوْ وَالْأَقْرَبِينَ. Is that right? Even if it is against your own interest or the interest of your relatives, family, or your own parents. Because justice should be above any of these genealogical, if you like, and biological relationships. Is that right? Is there something stronger than the blood relationship? Or one own self? Nothing. Quran is saying you have to put out. إِيَّكُنْ غَنِيًّا أَوْ فَقِيرًا. Poor or rich should not really matter. Socioeconomic, again. Okay? وَإِنْ تَلْوُوا أَوْ تُعْرِضُوا. Follow your own lust, your own desires, your own interest. You see? This is not accepted. When it comes to the high value, should be above every identity. As you can see, how these people, the Quran will say, أَفِي قُلُوبِهِمْ مَرَضْ. What is the problem with these people? Do they have a disease in their heart? Weakness in their heart? أَمْرْتَابُ. They are confused. One day they see, okay, I need to follow. The other day, they don't see it helping them. They go in the other direction. You see? I mean, so, you cannot do that. You cannot live this double life, as we say it. Again, remember how important to manifest the unity, at-tawheed, that you believe in manifest it at the personal level first. You have one heart and keep it undivided. Qalb salim. Undivided heart. You cannot say, okay, and this is a type of disease. Okay, these actions are reflective of this type of weakness. But Quran, when uses the word qalb, is talking about the core. That's why I like the French word for heart, cœur, which is core. Because really it's more reflective of your inside. It's not the muscle, the piece of muscle in our chest, but your core, your inside. If your inside and your outside are the same, what do we call that? Integrity, yeah? Integrity. You remember, like, I mean, you can, how they teach kids about integrity, because it is a very, very abstract concept. How can you teach a kid 6-7 years old about integrity? You need to use something concrete. You remember the M&M? Okay? The bag of anaman that has a true amanam, and it says amanam, and the other one, it says amanam from the outside, but the inside are not really amanam, but pebbles. So the inside is not compatible with the outside. The outside says amanam, but the inside is not amanam. The other one is true. And you know, integrity, from integrate, to how to integrate, to make something whole. These people, they don't have integrity. Quran is saying they don't have integrity. Because one day they say, we believe, and another day, and remember, Quran is not, notice, Quran doesn't, is not giving any names, any labels, but describing the situation, the case itself. It's not labeling.
If we label, what would be that then?
Quran, very, very good. Quran is trying to help us to understand the concept itself, not to just be interested in the label itself. Later, Quran will use munafiqun, or another place will use the term itself, but to tell us that it's not a matter of like this. A regimented way of classifying. In other words, I am also not immune to that disease.
So how do we differentiate?
You see, just let me elaborate a little bit on this. Because, for example, we talk about the disease of kufr, or the disease of hypocrisy or nifaq, and we think as if we are talking about something outside me. Okay? No, Quran is saying you are not immune. Be vigilant. Because you may be going in that direction. You may be doing certain practices that will not put you under that, completely under that label, but you may be going in that direction. This is why Muhammad ﷺ said, Ayatul Munafiqi Thalat, Ida Haddatha Kada, for example. So these are the signs, the characteristics of the hypocrite. If he's talking to you, his talk is full of lies. If I start lying, I am not totally hypocrite, but I am going. فيه صفة من صفات المنافقين.
Because I think the labeling is kind of free yourself from that.
As if I am not that. I'm not that. Yeah.
You're saying label somebody else.
Yes.
Label,
I am fine.
It's hard to label yourself. Include that.
It gives us this illusion that, oh, we are in a safe situation. Instead of looking at it as a disease that I need to protect myself from it, here comes taqwa. Taqwa is to avoid something. This is where that quality will help me to dispel, to protect myself from this to creep into my heart.
So Doug, when we think ourselves, when you are mu'minin, when you are munafiqin, I mean, Allah is also talking about the same thing.
Through qualities, through the qualities.
Well, one person can do error during this.
This is very good. Because really we are not in a static situation from day one. Quran, when in Surah Al-Alaq, اقرأ باسم ربك الذي خلق. The second half. أرأيت الذي ينهى عبدا إذا صلى أرأيت إن كان على الهدى أو أمر بالتقوى. Unfortunately, the early commentators, because they did not have enough data, they want to square that attribute on one person. This Quran is talking about this person, and Quran then it's on another person. No, Quran is talking about you and me, that we may be falling into these states. So there are good states and bad states. I have to be always seeking the good states, but be vigilant about the bad states. But I'm still the same human being, not somebody else. You see where is the, this is the beauty of Quran when it is really emphasizing on the description itself. More than so that you understand the label very well. Avoid it. But it's not really one time event. Okay? It's all the time. Be vigilant. Why you think at the end of Quran you see قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ As if Quran is saying till the end. You are reading Quran. Till the end, be vigilant about Satan and his entourage, about all the evils in life. I mean, you have to be vigilant all the time. Don't say, oh, I am fine. And then you start again. اهدنا الصراط المستقيم. You start again with Al-Fatiha. اهدنا الصراط المستقيم. Show us the right path. You see, it's a journey. Make sense?
Yeah, it does.
Yes.
The biggest problem I'm thinking is, in my opinion, that whenever we read these ayahs and the Quran, immediately we apply it to somebody else. Mm-hmm. It is for me.
Yes, before anybody else.
I should apply it on somebody else. Exactly. I should apply it on myself. That's the
first
whole idea.
The whole idea, yes. Yeah. Again, as individual, as and also as a community. Okay. Yeah. So, okay, Quran is saying, be vigilant, be aware. Nobody is immune. At any point, you may, God forbid, you may fall. But I am giving you the guidance so that you will not fall. Even if you fall, you know how to stand up. Even if you fall, I can help you to come out. But follow the guidance. Follow the light. أَفِي قُلُوبِهِمْ مَرَضٌ أَمْ ارْتَابُوا أَمْ يَخَافُونَ أَنْ يَحِيفَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ وَرَسُولُهُ Are they afraid that Allah or His Prophet will be unjust to them? Quran is saying immediately, بَلْ أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الظَّالِمُونَ No. بَلْ As if you are saying no to the previous statement. No, it is not that Allah or His Prophet are unjust. You are the unjust. So there is another disease, which is dhulm, the injustice. The injustice that is basically driving their actions, giving the direction to their act, to their actions. You see where is the direction? You see that how important in comparison with the universe? We need Allah wa Rasuluh. We need the revelation. We need the light in order to reflect that light. While the true believers, إنما كان قول المؤمنين إذا دعوا إلى الله ورسوله ليحكم بينهم أن يقولوا سمعنا وأطعنا وأولئك هم المفلحون قد أفلح المؤمنون So we have a new equality for the believers who not only say that they are believers but their actions reflect their belief. So if they are called upon for the Prophet or to the Prophet to judge among them, to give them the direction to their actions, they will say, "Sami'na wa at." Why? Because they believed that they need, they are conscious, as we said, like in the Friday khutbah, they become conscious of the importance of guidance in their life. There is a big difference between saying, I am doing this and I am doing it consciously. This is why I told you about your own kids and my kids, to tell them, okay, I want you to become conscious of the universe as the reference. They are doing it, but unconsciously. You see what I mean? We do many things by default, okay, automatically. But see, when you become conscious of it. You read Al-Fatiha, but read it now when you understand each word and each verse and the connection between them. Oh my God, it's completely different. You will enjoy it because you are conscious about it. You know what you are saying. And so that is really the attitude of the true believers. If you are saying that, otherwise don't say it, that you believe. You want more time? That's fine. Take your time. But once you really accept and embrace Quran as your reference for the direction, follow the direction. Or at least work on following the direction and the guidance. That would lead to success. Like قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. So in other words, it's a condition for success. Let us add today this very important rule. Following the guidance of the reference of direction is a condition for success. وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ. Whoever obeys Allah and His Prophet. وَيَخْشَ اللَّهَ. Appreciate Allah. It's very interesting that Quran would say, وَمَا قَدَرُ اللَّهَ حَقَّ قَدْرِهِ. You are underestimating Allah when you say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not provide us with guidance, with revelation to guide us in our life. مَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ بَشَرٍ مِّنْ شَيْءٍ. When you are denying this, you are underestimating Allah. Because Allah will not create without guidance. خَلَقَنِي فَهُوَ يَهْدِي. فَطَرَنِي فَهُوَ يَهْدِي. This is why in the khutbah I said, guidance is the reason that, the reason of being. We are not brought to being without guidance. And we are guided for our actions by the universe, and we are guided for the direction by the revelation. As simple as that. وَيَتَّقْهِ. Because also, you see, what is taqwa? Is highest level of vigilance. What does it mean when you want to avoid something? If you want to prevent accidents while you are driving, you drive drunk, you lose your vigilance. Wallahi, every day I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep that vigilance. Because the moment you lose that vigilance, you make a mistake. However, in driving or like in taking care of patients or taking care of your customers or taking care of your project. Vigilance, very important. To be awake. وَلَا تَجْعَلْنَا مِنَ الْغَافِلِينَ. You know this, what we say all the time, لَا تَجْعَلْنَا مِنَ الْغَافِلِينَ. To be heedless. Where you become heedless? When you lose guidance. So, يطيع الله ورسوله يخشى الله. Appreciate him. Not in the meaning fear, like that to get away from something, but you appreciate him in humility. You know your location, your status. And you know his status. أنتم الفقراء إلى الله. We are in need of him. But thankfully, he did it for us. He created us, but he did not leave us without guidance. From day one. From day one. Adam and his mate were sent down to earth. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, immediately فَإِمَّا يَأْتِيَنَّكُمْ مِنِّي هُدَى. Even without asking. Because they did not have any previous experience to ask. But later the human being become very conscious about it. They start asking. لَإِنْ لَمْ يَهْدِنِي عَسَى رَبِّي أَنْ يَهْدِيَنِي سَوَاءَ السَّبِيلِ. Yes.
So does that say that when Adam and Eve were left to their device in paradise before they made a mistake, they did not have guidance?
They have this guidance. You can eat from anything except this. Limited. They don't have a lot of experience. And so this, it was the first time they experienced the error, the mistake. And immediately together, man and the woman, together, they acknowledge, قَالَا رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا. Both. Don't put it on Eve. No, both of them acknowledge that they have done a mistake, and together they want to come out of it. They ask for repentance and transcendence. So now they want to start a new project on earth. They were not left without guidance. But the difference is one was unconscious about it. Now with Ibrahim alayhi salam became conscious about it. لَإِنْ لَمْ يَهْدِنِي رَبِّي لَأَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْقَوْمِ الضَّالِّينَ. I need you. I need my Lord to guide me. What do you expect the response to be? No guidance? Full guidance. Full guidance. Just ask him. Go to him. Do the right thing.
In this one ayah, Allah has used Muflihun. In the other one, Faizun. What is the difference between the two and why? What do you think?
Very beautiful. Muflihun. If we take really the root of the verb, it's basically falah. You know what is falaha? It's farming.
Farming,
yes. What do we call the farmer in Arabic? Falah. From falaha. What does the farmer do?
Creation.
You want really like to plant. You put one seed, how many seeds you get back? You see how the universe is very generous. في كل سنبلة مئة حبة. You put one seed, you get more. Quran is saying, if you do something good, you will not only get, the reward is not one good, it's not really a transaction. The regular transaction, you pay $5 and they give you in the amount of $5. The consequences are much more than the action itself. It's perpetual. You see, the farmer puts one seed and he got back 100. Do good thing, plant good thing in this life and see how much will be the revenue. In this life and in the hereafter. This is the true falah. And you remember what we said. Another condition for success is to believe. To believe in the unknown. Who creates? Who invents? Someone who believes in something still in the unknown. Is that right? And then they work towards it and they bring it to reality. But at one point, the iPhone was in the unknown. Computers were in the unknown. cars were in the unknown. If it were not for free people to create, to liberate themselves from what they have really achieved, or what humanity so far has achieved, there is no way to get into the next level. You have to believe. This is the meaning, I believe in Allah. You see, this is what, you believe in all these values that all emanate from His beautiful names. If you believe in Allah, Al-Khalaq, the Creator, the best Creator, you need to create. And this is the only, believe me, this is the best way to appreciate Allah being the Creator. Being Ahsanul Khaliqi. It means that there are creators. But He is the best among them. But you will not appreciate إِنَّمَا يَخْشَ اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءُ. This is what Quran is saying. The best people, most people who appreciate Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are the scientists. The knowledgeable people. Because they experience it. It's not a lip service. They work. And they say, oh my God. Like this guy I was told about, is a physicist, one of the famous physicists really, probably in the world. He was giving all these things and saying, light, I don't understand light. Fully. I mean, we know, say beyond this. Something more than that. Lot of mysteries. For a simple one, oh light, oh okay, I can see light. But go and study light and see. You will know where you are. What is your true status? But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to be higher and higher. To be the source of light. Is there more than that? Do you need more than that, my dear brothers and sisters? Honestly. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, مَثَلُ نُورِهِ. If you want to understand, let people see it. Through your light, they see the light of Allah. But today, you agree with me that people don't see that. They see the opposite. They see the darkness. Do you expect them to accept Allah? And then people will come and say, why there are so many people who become atheists? You are not showing the light. Do you expect these people to see Allah? You see, I mean, that as simple as this is why I'm telling everybody, I am not afraid of anything. I'm really very optimistic. I have no reason to be pessimistic. Because I know that we have a lot to offer. We have a lot to put on the table. Do you want me and you to defend Islam? Let them fight it. What they are going to do with it? يُرِيدُونَ لِيُطْفِئُوا نُورَ اللَّهِ. I mean, I'm saying it's, you are not talking about something simple. Who can provide a vision like this? Give me. I will take it today before tomorrow. I am with zero bias. I am like any human being, still discovering. Still in a journey of discovery. I will not stop. I hope that I will not stop that. And I want you to continue that journey of discovery. Again, does not mean if I discover something that yesterday I was not a believer. On the contrary, belief is a perpetual thing. It's a dynamic thing. Why Quran will say, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا آمِنُوا. Have you seen that verse in Quran? I'm sure you have seen it. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, oh you believe, believe. How come you call somebody you are a believer and you ask them to believe? How many times you see the same thing in the same verse? Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu taqullaha haqqa tuqatihi. Or taqullaha wal tanzur nafsu ma qaddamat lighad. Wa taqullah. So taqwa is not really like a static thing. Belief is not a static thing. And this is falah. Compatible with falah. This perpetual payback, if you like. The perpetual reward. The perpetual consequences of what you are really doing. The synergy that you see in your life. Faizun, also it means success. Okay? But it is interesting. Another term, mafaza. Fawz, mafaza, the same thing about success. But it's interesting that a big, like, desert is also called mafaza. Because if you can cross it and come out of it alive, this is the highest success. Yes. So, in other words, I see in Fawz and Faizun the struggle, the striving in order to reach. Success is not easy.
Continuous.
Very continuous. And even when you reach it, there is high possibility to be imprisoned in it. And then you start to lose again. And I shared with you before what Arnold Twombly said after he reviewed and 27 cultures and civilizations. He is a highly celebrated historian from England, the best in the 20th century, I would say. He summarized his journey of discovery with these four words: nothing fails like success. Teach it to your kids. Nothing fails like success. We are all seeking success, but be aware. Immediately put for yourself another mountaintop to make it perpetual and dynamic. Very beautiful. Why you think Iqbal would use rahimahullah would use the eagle as his motif in his poetry? To keep soaring from mountain top to another mountain top. Haphazardly he chose this motif? No, but to bring from the universe a very good ayah that will help us to see what does it really mean, elevation and success, true success. Make sense?
Yeah.
There may be more, I'm sure there will be more, but at least, I mean, this is what really comes to my mind, I mean, the idea of, I mean, really they called, in Arabic, we call the desert mafaza. But Quran also use it as really success.
You also mentioned Qalb-e Salim. Mm-hmm. Salim came from Salim.
Salim, yeah.
Salim like...
Undivided. Whole. W-H-O-L-E.
Yeah.
This is how I challenge the kids. I tell them, like, you want a whole heart or a heart with a hole? No, I mean, no, they said we want a whole heart. And we are created with one heart. مَا جَعَلَ اللَّهُ لِرَجُلٍ مِنْ قَلْبَيْنِ فِي جَوْفِهِ. You cannot take two directions at the same time. You cannot make two decisions at the same time. A very celebrated Taha Hussein, very highly celebrated, literary man from Egypt. When he saw this verse, he said, oh my God, there is nothing more than this. مَا جَعَلَ اللَّهُ لِرَجُلٍ مِنْ قَلْبَيْنِ فِي جَوْفِهِ. It really summarizes the human being, the core. You cannot have two hearts. You cannot have two directions. You cannot say, I am a believer and a disbeliever at the same time. You cannot say, I agree with you, I will take the guidance today and tomorrow. It's not an integrated heart. It is not a whole heart. This is why Ibrahim said, I want Allah to come to you with qalb salim. I want to come back to you with undivided heart. Is there more manifestation of monotheism at the level of the human being? What does it really mean then? If I believe in Allah as one and talk about it all the time, La ilaha illallah, tawheed is the most important, and then I find myself divided. No sense. At least in the Quranic narrative. This is why I am saying that no one can fight this. Tell anybody in this world, come and fight that. مَا جَعَلَ اللَّهُ لِرَجُلٍ مِنْ قَلْبَيْنِ فِي جَوْفِهِ. That's it. Come and fight it. Show that it is wrong. Nobody. No way. There is no way. Why you are afraid then? Why are you afraid? Why are we putting our kids in this, the dilemma? Provide them with something. Be positive. Be positive. Let them be positive. Let them talk about it in their classes. Because I understand that there is a big attack, and they feel it, the kids more than us, every day in their own classes. But to provide them with something, they can stand up better than you and me. They are more confident. I am not talking like in a theoretical way. I am in contact with these kids. Probably a couple years ago, I was not able to say it, but now I can say it. I am in contact, direct contact with them, and I can see it. Very confident of themselves. Very proud. But I don't want this proud to be hollow. No, based on something. They can put something on the table. You see? To help themselves and others around them. Ask Arshia, honestly. When she will tell her teachers about these concepts. Are you sure this is in Quran? I remember when my son want to say something during graduation, they asked each denomination to say something. And he talked about لَتَرْكَبُنَّ طَبَقًا عَنْ طَبَقٍ, about the human being. The challenge is to move from one orbit to another. People will come to me, are you sure that this is in Quran? It happened with me. I was telling someone, a colleague at work, we say every day in our prayer, Alhamdulillah Rabb al-Alamin, he said, and I thought that we believe praises are given to Allah, to God, who is really the Lord of all worlds. He said, are you sure? This is what you say? Don't take things for granted. People don't know. But the ones they see, You believe in God who is really the Lord of everybody, not for you. They think that we believe in God who belongs to me. Or unfortunately, this is what has been presented probably. My God versus your God. What are you talking about? There's nothing like that. Quran never. Ilahuna wa ilahukum wahid. Allahu Rabbuna wa Rabbukum. No, never. Quran talks about this is your God and this is my God. Or this is your prophet, this is my prophet. This is the way we tell. Oh, your prophet said this and my prophet. What are you talking about? What are we talking about? يُفَرِّقُونَ بَيْنَ اللَّهِ وَرَسُلِهِ لَا نُفَرِّقُ بَيْنَ أَحَدٍ مِّنْهُمْ. What are you talking about? Honestly. Who will fight this? Who will come out, I mean, of this really victorious? None. So be proud. But not a hollow pride. Something based on beautiful, deep concepts that not only challenging us, challenging every human being. So I hope that I was able to show you that importance, fundamental, really concept. Okay? Through the verses, you see the unity. The same way Quran is talking about social practice, it's talking about the universe. The same way it's talking about the revelation. It's one thing. Life is one. Jazakumullah khairan. Thank you very much.